system periphery. What does it mean? One second, I think probably I need to
pick time.
Unlock it. Okay. And let the go to meeting to use it. Okay.
Sandy, right, on the bottom, if you don't see share screen, I think you can click the screen button there too.
Oh, okay. This is a share screen. All right.
There
so you can see my screen.
Yep.
Yeah, we can see your screen now.
All right.
Oh, I can see my screen. All right. Shall we start?
Enlarge it.
Yeah. Well, I'm so glad to share some of my image making and post processing. But my post processing probably is very simple. But first of all, I have no any financial relationship with the product. I want to mention several products in this talk, mention these presentations. So let's talking about the processing, the post-processing. I use Lightroom most of time. Occasionally, I will use the Photoshop. Nick, I use a lot, like the Define. I use it for the noise reductions. But since last couple of months, I got the Topaz. I find that the noise from the Topaz is much better than the Define. So I use the noise more and more. But for the Nick, I also use the Vivitar and the silver for the black and white too. Sometimes when I try to decrease noise a lot, seems it's like the, for example, like doing the Milky Way in a very dark night, so get a lot of noise. I use this product called Noisewell, and because that they can depress noise a lot. So sometimes I use this one too. So let's get an example here. So these photos, probably most of you probably see these photos already. So I show in the National Geography, your shot 2017, and also appear in the Photo Clear last year, get a first prize. So what I got this photo is in winter time, after we cross-country ski in Badger Pass, and then come down to the valley view. Usually after the cross-country ski in the winter time, we either go to tunnel view or the valley view for the opportunity of sunset shot. At that time, this 2 years ago, and I used the Canon 1DX with 16 to 35 millimeter at 27 millimeters, ISO 100. The aperture is 22. At that time, the reason I use 22 is because I don't have 10 step neutral density filters. I only have 5 stopped, so I have to put the aperture very small. This may create a problem for the diffractions. The reason I want to add this filter, and so I'm trying to get the 8 second, at least like 5 seconds or so, to make the water, the river, kind of silky and fuzzy. So I put the density filter along with the polarized filter too, trying to help me to get 8 seconds. At the meantime, I lower the camera very low, very close to the waters, then I can get the scene kind of to get the water, get the foggy, get everything. I was pretty lucky at that time when I arrived there, the sky kind of no clouds at all. But when you reach to the almost a sunset, there's some clouds coming in, so they create a good dramas right there.
Beautiful.
The only thing I don't have in this is those snow bomb. I wish I have some snow bomb right there. So let's look at the processing here. So as I say, I usually use the Lightrooms. So this is the raw file for my Canon, the CR2. So what I do, let me see the, I'm going to see this. Can I move? Oh yeah, here you go. Move to this side. So white balance, usually I keep it a shot or auto. It depends to see which one give me a better looking. So I will try the a shot or auto. Maybe I'll try autos this time. And then the tone, everything, also I use the autos at this time. Now, for the highlight, I usually pull the highlight to the left and pull the shadow to the right. And also look at the white. I pull it to the right side until it's showing the triangle right there. Or you can use the options. I'm using the Apple computers. So you can press option with the white. And then you see some too much white right there. You can bring it down to until barely see it. So it's the same thing like the triangle right there. And also for the black, and I pull to the left side until you see a little bit of the black right there. Or you can see a triangle right there. And then pull it back a little bit. And texture, I just move back and forth to see which one until the level I like. It's a little bit clear, same thing, I just move back and forth a little bit. And the haze, yeah, this is pretty important for me. I usually adjust quite a bit until it show up what I need. And I like, and most of them I hardly ever touch at all. And to the drop in and noise reduction, I just do that little bit only. Usually I would mask it. You see, just I want to do those guides too much. And then noise reduction, I just do a little bit because I'm gonna do the noise reduction in the other program. The other thing I will pay attention is the level. Sometimes I use auto and or use the level and to see, make sure the level is good enough. The last thing I would adjust sometimes is the blue primaries. I might increase a little bit with the blue and probably half weight to the right. And then the exposure, I will come down a little bit. At this point, I would go to the Nick. Usually I use a define. At that time, I use a define.
Dr. Lee?
Yes.
This is Jonathan. I want to take a moment and explain to those that are listening that if you have a question, put it in the chat. There's an icon on the right side top, and you can type in questions, and I will relay them to Dr. Lee. Okay, please continue. Doing a great job, my friend.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. So this is define. Define, basically, it denotes pretty good. This is, the noise is not much at all. You're only a little bit the dot right there. So I save. All right, the next process I would do usually is I go to a Vividzas 2. This going to local adjustment because I don't want the water is too bright. So I would, but first of all, I would adjust a little bit the whole picture. So either I pull a little bit everything to the right, adjust a little bit, and then the brightness, I will adjust left and right to see which location is more comfortable. Sometimes I increase a little bit, sometimes I decrease a little bit, just a little bit. And then I'll go to the local. Local, I would decrease the brightness on the waters. So usually I come down a little bit, and then you can use the option with the with this circle right here. You can copy, basically it's copying the same things. And then the cloud, I would like to bring a little bit more redness. So I would reduce the brightness a little bit and increase the warm tone a little bit. So bring it up a little bit right there. Yeah, this is just a copy the same adjustment. Now, if this area, the very dark area, if you want to increase a little bit, you can do that too, just increase a little bit the brightness and also the structure. You can increase the structure a little bit. So basically, this is almost done for me. So usually one picture, I can take probably 5 minutes or so, and I probably can finish. Now, as I say, recently I use Topaz. Topaz pretty good. The reason I would like to the Topaz the noise is they reduce the noise and increase the sharpness at the same time. But it takes a little bit more time though. So I usually use their auto, and then just hit apply. This takes a little bit more time than they are defined. But I find that it did not decrease the noise better than the define. So I use more and more lately. Almost done. Okay, good. So this basis is almost done. The only thing I would like to do is I might crop it a little bit. I would like to have the 16 by 9 user list. So I may crop it like that. So maybe this crop too much. Maybe cut down a little bit on the original custom. Oh, I don't know how come I'm not able to go to customs. Not sure. But anyways, I would like to cut the upper part a little bit and then the bottom part a little bit. But this is not this one. Oh, no wonder. Okay, that's probably almost done. Any questions so far for this image?
There was a question about noise reduction. I think you explained it at the beginning, but if you want to take a moment and recap, that would probably be appreciated.
Okay, the noise, as I say, recently after I get the Topaz, let me go back. Where's my, here you go. Oh, I cannot see my. Yeah, Topaz. That the noise is pretty good. I think it's better than define. So what I do is usually I would do that before I do other process, after the Lightroom. So, because it's into the Lightroom, so I can go to the right click the picture and then go to edit in this Topaz, the noise. Usually their auto is very good. I don't need to do any manual one unless they increase too much sharpness. So I would bring their sharpness down to keep the noise, because sometimes they can over sharpness. So auto and then apply, then you are done. The close cancel it. Now, if you use the Ning, this is very easy in, it takes very short time. Yeah, only a little bit of noise, little tiny bit on it. Let's go to the second image. Same thing. This image also is taken in the Yosemite's glacial point. It also appear in National Geography's your shot 2 years ago. The image was taken with a Nikon, so I changed it to a Nikon D850. This length 28 to 300 millimeters is not that good. If you exceed 150 millimeter, the focus is pretty soft, and at 85 is still okay. So the ISO is 100 0.5 second at f13. It's a pretty standard shot. So let's see the original one. What are they? Here we go. Yeah. Here's the let me see the this is a raw fight. Yeah, Nikon's raw fight. So what I do, same things. Basically when I finish one image process, I can save the I can
I'm on it.
I can set the preset, then I can use it for next time. For example, I do have a preset here, it's called Sonnet. So basically it's the same process like I do in the last image. And then I go back to develop to do some fine tune. Either this is a shot or it's an auto. I just want to see which one is better for me. A shot, it's an auto. I think probably auto is a little bit better for me. And then I would do auto again. And decrease the highlight, increase the shadow, and then the white. I would bring to the right size a little bit, and then the dark to the left side a little bit, and then decrease the tone until I like it. So this cloud become a warm tone and the redness here. And the texture to move back and forth to see which one give me a better appearance. And then clarity, the haze. The haze is very important. So you can make the picture really pop. And the blue primary, I increase a little bit right here. So red lights are pretty good. The other thing I would like to do probably is a gradual filter right here. So make it a sky a little bit darker, a little bit bluish. Yeah. Okay. And then I will crop it, make it a little bit less on the top. You see a lot of spot right here. So I might just clean up some spot. Yeah, there's some right here, I will do that later. But this is just an idea to do that. So basically this is almost done for my standard process. So I'll go to the noise again. The noise, so topaz, the noise. Again, increase your sharpness too. is coming. Yeah, here we go. Again, I use auto. And then I can move around. And if you click it, see here, you click this is before, this after. So you can see the before and after. And then apply.
Dr. Lee?
Yes.
What do you do about the halos?
The halo?
Yes.
Yeah, you mean that edge that is a halo?
Yes.
Yeah, usually like because you enlarge so big you can see it, but if I just give it a presentation in the phone or look at your screen, probably I don't need to worry about that. But if you are going to print the big one, then probably I need to do a little bit of halos. Usually you can do that in the right room.
Okay.
Yeah, if we go back to the right room, probably I did not do it this one. This halo is not that bad, but when you increase 400%, you can see that 400%.
Yes.
Yeah.
So it's more of an issue when you're printing.
Yeah, the printing, you're going to see it. So if I really I plan to print it, then I probably have to take care of it. Yeah, this Topaz is kind of a little bit slow. Now, if we just look at in the computer and your phone, probably you're okay. You don't see anything right there. But you can do it here. I usually, remove the Chrome operations. This usually you can take care of it, and then you can adjust right here too. It takes some time to find the good place and reduce the pink one or reduce the blue ones. So basically, these pictures probably is I would stop here. But what I see is these skies is a little bit still too bright here. So I might bring it to the gradient filter one more time. Too much, just a little bit, maybe, just a little bit. Yeah, just a little bit like that. Yeah. Now, when I taking picture like this, if I have time, I have 30 minutes. Usually I would take time lapse pictures. This is one of the time lapse pictures. So the advantage is when you take time-lapse picture, you can choose one of it. This is only a single image from a series of time-lapse. And then you can use all the image to create a time-lapse movie. Also, you can choose some of them to put them together, kind of stacking, then create a like a long exposure shot. So you can create three presentations. I mean, from the one image process. I'm going to show you a little bit later on about this time-lapse too. So this is the second image. In the meantime, also, if I can go to a place like Yosemite, because it's easier to reach it, I don't need to hike too much, I usually bring two cameras, one for time-lapse. The other one, I just play around to change the focus and change the time and play around. And so the other cameras just sit still there to take the serious time-lapse pictures. But if I'm going to hiking, going to backpacking, usually I just bring one camera with a tiny one because it's too heavy. Okay, let's see, go back here. Now, as I said, you can use the serious timeless pictures and start them together. You can create a stacking image. This is the image also taken in the tunnel build with the Leica Q 28mm length. This is 30 image stacking together. This is a long process. Sometimes it takes about 1 hour for the computer to finish the work. But this also is easy to do. Let's say, I just give you an example here. See, this is the whole bunch similar pictures. That's timeless. Wow. Yeah, this is just this is a part of it. It's totally a 400 picture right here. So you can put them together and then become a timeless. Let's say that if you want to create a stacking, so you choose whatever you want. Let's say this is about 12 picture, and then right click, and then add it in open layer in Photoshop. Open layer in Photoshop. So they would do that enough, and then you choose all the layer and add it in Photoshop. Let them auto combine and auto stack in. And then you just process it just like the single image. So this is the kind of time consuming, probably you're not going to go into there tonight.
Dr. Li, is ghosting an issue when you composite?
It depends. It depends. Like the tree. If you have a wind, then the tree might become a ghostly image. So it depends. Not all the images you can do stacking. So you have to try. You have to try to see which one can give you a good good outcome. Yeah, this is a 30 image together. It's lucky enough you see all the trees are pretty sharp. It means that the wind is not that bad.
Looks nice.
Yeah, and then you will put all the images together. You can create a movie. Here we go. Let me show you this one. Let me make it a little bigger. Great from
Wow, nice.
Yeah, let's try one more time. And also notice the whole view is kind of moving to the right. You can do this process just like the similar to the hardware movement. And this is the software movement. It moves from the left to the right. You go. Also the right to the left, whatever you want, or up and down. This is another image I got from the Yosemite's Valley View. Show this one too. Unfortunately, there's no sunset. Red cloud. The snowing days. Now, if we have several of these kind of clip, you can put them together, put in the iMovies, and then you can create the movie or project at the this is the iMovies. Yeah, you can put this image into the editing area, and then finally you get the music together. Then you have a very nice presentation. But how to do this kind of movies? The program, there's one program called LR Time Lapse. This is a very good program, it's very easy to use. They use this program together with Lightroom. So you can edit your image in these programs, and then transfer to the Lightroom, and then export as the movie. So this one is pretty easy to use too. So LR is a Lightroom. Actually, it's a LR is a Lightroom. Lightroom time lapse and iMovie together. So this is kind of different kind of topics. I'll just show you what I did for this kind of movie.
Great.
So the next topic probably are going to discuss a little bit about the equipment and the lens and the app what I use. So a couple years ago I used the Canons, and then the Nikon become available. So I found the Nikon's better than the Canon 5D3, so I get the D85, and then Sony probably a little bit better than the Nikon is a lightweight, because I'm hiking and backpacking all the time. So usually for the hiking and backpacking, I take the Sony with me. The Sony with the Canon lens, actually. So it's a Canon lens. And this lens is very good, actually. So. But if just go to Yosemite, I don't have to hike too much. Usually I take both of the Nikon and the Sony. So one of them is for the time-lapse, the other one I can play around to get other pictures. But for taking picture of birds and wildlife, Sony with the, no, at least not a Canon. This is a Sony's, sorry. Yeah, the Sony is the 200 to 600 millimeter. This lens is pretty good. It's very good. Filters. Usually, I don't put any filters in front of the lens. The most common filter I use is a graduate nature density filters. That's kind of the halfway filters, because I can darken the skies a little bit. Now, if we're going to a long distance, like the hiking, I usually use this tripod. This tripod, it can take two of the leg out. It become the hiking pole. You can buy the handheld. This kind of handheld, they have a knife inside and also survival kit inside there. The handle right here, and then they become the hiking pole. Or you can just get the handles without anything. Like that, if you have to go to the airport, these things are not able to go to the airport at all. If go to Yosemite, you don't need to hiking at all, for sure I'm going to bring those large steady tripod. But I have been using this tripod a lot. Actually, it's very lightweight, but it's pretty stable, very stable. I've been using this tripod for about 2.5 years, and it worked very well. Now I'm going to show you some of the app I have. One of them is called Photo Pills. This one I use it mostly is to look at the Milky Way. It says I'm hiking to a lake, like a remote area, and I try to find a good place for the Milky Way at night. So usually I can play around, and you see this, I take a picture. This is two days ago in my backyard. So you see this Milky Way, and then you can have a background. Then you know where you want to come back at night. And also you can see what time the Milky Way show you up in which location. And also they have a lot of other functions too. I hardly ever use them. You look at the sunrise, sunset, and the moonlight, moonset. So this app is pretty good. I use it basically as synth, like when I go to the one location, I use it to find a good location. And the other app called Planet, this one, you can plan it before you go to the place. And so this is actually it's the glacial point. So I can find out what time the Milky Way is about the glacial point, and what time it disappear, when is the best time to take the Milky Way. Like the June 19, 2020 is from 10:23 to about this, what time? It's totally probably seven hours. You can take this Milky Way. And the good thing is you can plan ahead and simulate it. But this take a little bit more time to get familiar with. Those two apps I use most for my to plan my photo the photography. The other app I use a lot is for hiking. Actually, it's very important. If you go to hike, go to backpacking, you want to have a very good GPS app. This is a Gaia GPS. This one is you can make a plan in the computer, and then you can synchronize into your phone, and you can follow the hiking trail, and in case you get lost, you can bring it back to the original place. It's very good. And also all trails is very good too. The other important device is Garmin InReach. These are satellites, SOS. You can call helicopters in case you get hurt and get injury, you need a helicopter to rescue you. So this device is very important. Often you hear someone kind of injury or even die in a remote area because get lost in a hiking trail. If they have this kind of app and have this kind of device, I mean, those accidents probably can be avoided. So those is very important if you want to go out for hiking. So this is a couple of apps I often use. Now, so far, any other question? Now, if not, basically, photo processing for my post processing is pretty simple, but I spend more time actually to schedule, to plan my shot. So the post processing, I basically use the Lightroom most of times, adjacent with the Nick and Topaz. And also say, I usually take a series of photos and then put them together, become a become a movies. So I was going to this going to show you two movies I make before. So one is the hiking to a Thousand Island Lake. This is in the Jomeo Trail area. They have a music too. So this was very short. We spend one night in the Thousand Island Lake. It take about 10 miles to get there. Elevation gain probably about 2,000 or so. So it's a pretty early. The Milky Way, if they have clouds, actually it's better than without clouds. They have some clouds that they're giving a kind of different movement. The Milky Way move one direction, the cloud move one direction, and give us more dramatic feeling. The other movie I did is for the Dolomite hiking, the AV1 hiking. We hike 50% of the of the trail, take about 6 days hiking there in the Italy, northern Italy. Is a very pretty areas. I supposed to go back there this year to hike the other parts, but unfortunately not able to go there this year. So I'm going to show you probably this this movie here. Yeah, a little bit longer. Yeah, I think that's it. That's my all my presentation tonight. It's pretty simple, actually, sir.
Very nice.
Thank you. Thank you.
Sorry. Very nice.
Thanks.
People are pretty shy about typing in some questions. Take a moment and encourage everybody to ask a question. This is a wonderful photographer, and I'm not sure when we're going to be able to have him back. So now's your chance. Please take a moment and see if you can come up with a couple of questions.
Well, because my processing, this is pretty simple. Probably everybody can do that, yeah.
I tried to unmute everybody in case people just wanted to talk. So if you guys have questions, go ahead.
Good idea. Speak up.
Wonderful images.
Okay, well, I'm typing it. Is the Vs filter in Photoshop as well as Lightroom?
Pardon me, it says what? Say that again.
You use the haze filter, which I used to use in Elements a lot, but I have not been able to find it in Photoshop.
Oh, Photoshop. I hardly ever use Photoshop at all. So I'm not so familiar. Actually, it should have though in the Photoshop's supposed in the what the raw processing. I think
in the raw editor, John. It's in the raw editor in Photoshop.
Should be able to do that in Photoshop, not in the Photoshop itself, but the Photoshop the raw processing, I think.
Yes.
Yeah.
In Photoshop raw processing.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. Because I haven't found it with JPEG, I know that.
Yeah, the JPEG probably not in that area. But you can process the JPEG in the raw processing program right there too.
Yeah, I mean I could start in Lightroom and then transfer it. How do you transfer it from Lightroom to Photoshop?
Transfer, you mean that you, if you want to edit in the Photoshop, you should be able to do that in the Photoshop. So let me show you here. Okay, here's a, let's say this picture, and then you can right click, edit in, you see here, open, as a smart object in Photoshop. Yeah, you can actually edit over there.
Okay, so you go into edit and you go down to the bottom there in the Photoshop and it transfers it over.
Yeah. Okay. And the good thing is that the smart image in when you change it in the Photoshop that they save it into the Lightroom too.
Yeah. Okay. I've worked with mostly Photoshop, but I see some features in Lightroom that I like real well that you were using.
Yeah, the Photoshop is too complicated for me. I just use Lightroom. I feel that Lightroom is good enough for me because I don't do much of the editing in the post processing, and lately. I really like to change the background, change the sky, something like this. I try to learn it in Photoshop. I tried it several times, and it's, every time I learn it, and then I forget how to do it. Until later, actually, so it's easier to do that with the Topaz. Topaz have the programs that you can change the sky very, very easy, actually. So.
By the way, Topaz has a number of programs that they've produced now that I've been using, and they've been really good. The noise, the sharpen, you can take an image and add more pixels to it, the gigapixels. And they've got about four or five of them that are really good programs.
I have those programs too. Those are. This one is very good for the wildlife because if you want to crop the image, then you can. You want me to update? And then you can increase the pixels from here.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Topaz actually is doing very good job.
Mm-hmm. It's just like you say, sometimes you have to wait about a minute and a half to 2 minutes for it to load.
It's take a long time compared to other programs. You have to be patient.
Bonnie asked a question as well. She's wondering what kind of graduated filter do you use, and is it screw on or drop in?
I'm not sure what you're asking. It says a drop in. What do you mean drop in into the program?
Bonnie,
it has a holder. Yeah. I've seen different types. Some are just a screw on, graduated filter. Some have a system where you.
That's right. In. Yeah, mine is a very old one. It's a kind of round shape. It kind of screw in. Now that the new one, you can just it's a minute. You can just touch it. Then you very easy to use. Mine is a kind of screw in. If I going to hiking or going to take a picture of the landscape, I usually keep it right there. Actually, keep it in front there in my legs.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, the other one I used before is a square. All the squares are too much troubled. It's take too much space. I have two. One is a 77 millimeter. The other one's 82 millimeters. So basically those two lengths, and that is good enough for most of the lengths.
Yeah.
Dr. Lin, you have an 850, and some of the other cameras you said you use for landscape or whatever. What specifically do you use the 850 for, the Nikon 850?
Nikon 850, actually this I got before Sony's. So before I get the Sony, I use the Nikon, the 850. Almost all the times, even though I go to hiking, go to just a general landscaping, but when Sony become available, because it's about 10 ounces less than Nikon, so that's why I got it. Both of them are very good cameras, very good.
Yes.
Just because are lightweight. For me, for backpacking, every ounce count. So I have to try to reduce any weight in my bed.
Is it a single lens reflex? Sony? Is the Sony a single lens reflex?
Sony is the mirrorless. The mirrorless. Yeah. Yeah, Nikon 850 there's a mirror right there. Yeah, that's why it got a little bit heavy. But I heard that Canon have a R5. That's very good too, isn't it?
Who?
Canon R5.
Canon.
Yeah, Canon.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a new camera, but it's still a little bit heavier than Sony. Yeah, Canon, they have a new mirrorless called R5.
What number? What's the code for it? You know?
You mean like R5?
Yeah, it's 5 or 6, 7B or?
Yeah, R5, yeah.
It's a
new camera. This one, the new cameras, yeah. Just available this year, yeah. But the pistol is less than the Sony, and also it's a little heavier than Sony, so I'm not considering it.
Dr. Lin, you've had some images in National Geographic. Tell us a little bit about that.
Those two is in the National Geographic your shot, but right now it's not available. They changed it to Instagram actually, so So this is appeal in 2017, January 23rd, the daily doctrine. And also the other one is appeal in May 2018. And then I have another one too, that's a little bit longer than that, 2017, 2016. This is the Maras wildlife. Yeah, those two is in the daily thousands. But they changed to Instagram, and then I don't use Instagram at all. So I don't send a picture at all.
Dr. Lin, do you do your own printing?
Before, yes, I did my own printings for the our camel crops competition. This a long time ago, and then I don't print at all. Probably 5 or 6 years ago, that's why I don't participate any print competitions. I stand out to print, basically the print out like a large print, like a 20 inch, 30 inch, those kind of print. I send out to the other company to print for me and put in my office. But I don't do my own printing at all.
Which company?
Whichever kind of discount. I forgot which one.
No favorites?
No.
No favorites right now?
No.
Okay.
But recently I don't print much at all because I still have a lot of kind of image kind of photos putting in my office. There's no space anymore, so I don't print it.
No room for anymore.
Yeah. But I do make more and more this kind of movie. Actually, it's the timeless movie. I really like it. Yeah. The time spent in this kind of movie actually is to find a good music, and you need to chorus the music with your image. This is kind of difficult. You have to spend time and then to find to edit it and then to put them together. So those are time consuming.
How do you go about 25 or 30 pictures?
Because 1 second for the movies, they need about 30 frames. So if this is kind of standard, the program you make it for you. So every second of the movie, you need 30 image actually. So if you want to have usually like 10 seconds or so, then you have need about 300 image. So when you go to the timeless, you can picture yourself and how long the movie you want. So at least you want to have so many image. The timeless, usually you put in 5 second interval. It depends on the crowd. If the crowd will be too fast, then you probably want 1 second, 2 seconds or so. If the crowd moving so slow, you can do like 10 seconds, it depends. And for the Milky Way, like this kind of Milky Way, this basically is the whole night, about 4 hours, 3 or 4 hours, basically one battery, I put a brand new battery and then let it take it off. And then next morning I'm going to collect it. And basically take about 300 to 400 pictures or so, depending on the weather. If the weather is so cold, it may be less, because battery doesn't work too well say, in the cold weather. So usually you have 300 or 400 pictures, then you have about 10 seconds or 15 seconds of the Milky Way movie clip.
So what kind of
Dr. Lin, do you bring an extra external hard drive with you, portable hard drive? How do you get your images?
Yeah, hard drive usually I don't unless you go to the place like the Dolomites, because I will stay in the heart. Some of the heart have electric, so I can back up. Actually, Dolomite, no, I'm the apricot. In the apricot, like the wildlife safari. So we stay in the heart and they have electric, and we also have a car. You don't have to hide too much. So I bring my computer with me, then I can put those images into the hard drive. But for this kind of trip, because you have to hike, I don't bring my hard drive, but I bring a lot of those memory cards. A lot of memory cards. Usually I have 10 memory cards, each one of the 128. So to make sure I don't run out of it. Because if you are going to do those kind of timeless pictures, you need a lot of memory cards. A lot of memory cards, especially when shooting with the Sony or the Nikon, because each one have a 61 megapixel.
Wow. More questions for Dr. Lin, please.
Each picture in when you do the movie is 61 megapixels.
Yeah, 61, yeah. And
if you got 100 of those, you got a lot of megapixels.
A lot, yeah. So you have to bring a lot of those memory cards.
Chips, thumb drives.
Hard drive, yeah. If you travel and you can stay in a hotel, then it's no problem. So every night when you go back to the hotel, you can put in a hard drive.
Dr. Lin, one of our members has a printing service, Patrick Grames. Patrick, you want to give yourself a plug?
Oh,
well, if anybody has large or small format printing on a very sophisticated printer, state of the art, give me a call.
Wait, sure.
Thanks, Patrick.
What kind of price would you put on a 12 by 18?
12 by 18, okay.
Is that a question for Patrick?
Yeah, that's a question for Patrick.
You know, it depends on what kind of paper you want it on, but a 12 by 18, I'm just gonna off the top of my head say right around $20, maybe a little less. I'd have to plug into the spreadsheet the actual kind of paper you want to use.
Mm-hmm.
I've got several different papers, and the better papers, of course, are more expensive.
Of course.
Okay, some more questions for Dr. Lin. Really appreciate you being here tonight, Dr. Lin. And
you're welcome. Well,
thank you, Dr. Lin.
Much everyone, and I really humbled. I'm consider myself as amateur and just like to do a photography. That's it, and my is a pretty simple process. And compared to most of you, I really feel that I asked me to share my opinion about the processing.
We appreciate the time that you've shared with us tonight. Thank you very much. If there aren't any other questions, we'll draw this to a close.
I have one. I'm just curious. When you go on your trips, do you have a few photographer friends that you like to go with, or do you plan them on your own? How do you do that?
Yeah, actually, I have a friend who also is my colleague and my friend, and we kind of working together and find a trip. If we can go together, the time convenient. So basically, we like to go with my friend together, because in the remote areas, go just by yourself is really scary, especially if you spend overnight over there. So usually we have four people together, and my wife, and then there are a couple together with four people, and then kind of more fun, and then also have a companion, and also we can do those playing together.
Now, did you do Thousand Island Lakes in one day, or did you go up and stay overnight backpacking?
Yeah, it depends. It depends. Most of the time, it's just one day, and most only 2 days. If 3 days, that's a little bit too much because you carry too much food, and also it stays 3 nights outside, and it's pretty tough. Usually, we train like 1 night, 2 nights. That's the most common. Well, easier to handle it. Like suppose this weekend we are going to Horton Lake again, but was canceled yesterday by the ranger because ranger station says that the whole area closed, so we're not able to go there anymore. Suppose North Lake and the Horton Lake area have a very nice color at least time. This is peak already, the four colors peak, but unfortunately the area is closed.
Well, I have to tell you, I admire you if you go to Thousand Island and back, because I've been there, and really? Exactly the picture you took, I've seen that, and it's beautiful.
Yeah, really good. That's area. A
long hike.
Yeah, it's beautiful, yeah, Thousand Island, yeah. And Jomel Trails, all the area in Jomel Trails is very beautiful, but it's difficult to reach there.
Elizabeth, do you have any questions?
I can't think of any. I do appreciate you sharing, Dr. Lin.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Yeah, on behalf of the whole club, even the ones that aren't here, I appreciate you taking the time to do what you've done for us. Outstanding.
All right, I guess this comes to an end here. Thank you again, Dr. Lin, and all the participants tonight. This is being recorded by Elizabeth, and I think will be made available later, right, Elizabeth?
Yes, I'll put it online and send the link to everybody.
Okay.
Great. Thanks, Elizabeth.
Thank you.